Greetings, Facebook Live family. This is Brother Shaq, True Love Movement. And I wrote a book called Resolving Rape Culture. And so far I've done too many, I'm calling them mini Rona readings from the book, especially since we're not able to go out and gather and, you know, have another book signing. Today, actually, the 13th, makes 2 months since the book has been out, and it's done really well. I'm extremely proud of how that's how that's gone, especially considering, you know, our current circumstances where folks are quarantined. You know, the good news is, with regard to the quarantine, I hope everyone is well who's watching. Of course, we're going to wait a few minutes for some folks to come on in, but the good news is, while we are quarantined, Resolving Rape Culture is a good book to add to your quarantine reading list. You know, folks are asking about what to read, you know, during this particular time when many of us are shut indoors and we're being encouraged, aggressively encouraged to stay put, stay indoors. So we're reading more and we're studying and, you know, that kind of a thing. So I would strongly recommend Resolving Rape Culture to be a part of your reading list during this time. You know, particularly as looking at some of the reports of domestic violence and other forms of abuse ticking up as folks are in close quarters, and unfortunately we knew this would happen. Greetings everyone who's joining. Shout out, I see my brother Michael Pellet there. What's happening, brother? We got a sister, Christian Malo. Greetings, sis, how are you? And I want to thank y'all for joining. Again, I'm going to give folks a few more minutes to come on in and check this out. If you're so inclined, if you've watched, on somewhere on my timeline is the reading of the introduction and reading of parts of the religion chapter from the Resolving Rape Culture book during these mini Rona readings, is what I'm calling them. And those videos are also available on the True Love Movement TV YouTube channel. And if you haven't caught those, I would encourage you after this one to see those so you can get more of a picture of what's happening. Big shout out to everybody who already has the book. Been shipping out a lot of books for the last couple of weeks or so once I got some more in, and I've have a handful left. This is the revision, the revised edition, where a couple of things were added a things people wanted, you know, from feedback, a table of contents, and kind of made some adjustments on the introduction that I read last week. And then the in the back there's about 20 blank pages for notes, for note taking, because it is the kind of book that you may want to jot a few things down about what you're reading. And so on tonight, very briefly, I'm going to read from the athletics chapter, which is the A in the acronym of RAPE. And if you've not seen the previous videos, the acronym RAPE, as defined by True Love Movement, is religion, which we covered last week. We read from the religion chapter. Athletics, which I'm going to do just a little bit from tonight. Politics and entertainment. That is the RAPE acronym in the Resolving Rape Culture book. Of course, we know the word resolving means that we are making a serious determination about doing something. And it also is defined by breaking something down into its parts. And so with regard to religion, athletics, politics, and entertainment, we're taking a look here at how these four areas have impacted the normative life experiences for exclusively black women and girls, or rather those women and girls who are now today politically designated as black. And in doing that, we're looking at a we're developing a historical analysis on how things came to be the way that they are. And what's important about this work is, for many, the talk about rape culture in very contemporary terms in pop culture, popularized culture, it really invisibilizes the circumstances that produce the actual sexual assaults in that particular climate and the ways in which people are acculturated. So when we hear the phrase or the words rape culture, we're immediately drawn to the sexual assaults and sexual violations that occur and occur at a very, very high frequency. We know that 1 in 3 women, according to reports, 1 in 3 women will be sexually assaulted before the age of 18. But then again, we also know that only 12% actually report. So those numbers are still very, very low as it relates to who's definitely been directly impacted by the sexual assaults and sexual violence against women in general. But as a black man, my interest is resolving rape culture as it relates to black women and girls. As someone who came from a black woman and who has produced black daughters, my interest is and allegiance is in fact to black people. So this book looks at our unique historical experiences and brings us up to current day to demonstrate what are the things that happen in terms of how we're conditioned, socialized, and acculturated in America that produce the violence against specifically black women and girls and make that normative. You know, during these talks, I always ask people to tell me what the penalty is for violating a black woman or a black girl. No matter how large the group, there's usually a very unanimous consensus that there isn't a penalty. Everybody seems to know that. And so I then asked the group, well, why are we okay with that? Because clearly we are, since everyone knows. And so I realized that we all have a responsibility to usher in and bring forth and support the healing and reconciliation around the black woman and girl experience. And to that end, black men and boys, good black men and boys in particular, I think are very instrumental in doing that with the leadership of black women and girls. So this particular, you know, as we read through the religion chapter, you know, that religion chapter was pretty heavy. If you haven't seen that video, I would encourage you to check that out just to go back to bring yourself up to speed. And of course, what was read in the video is not the chapter in its totality, because that would just be too long of a video. But we landed on the advent of the Negro preacher. And of course, the Negro preacher is the predecessor for the black preacher of today, and his charge with teaching the Bible and to his flock and so forth. And so we just look at an interrogation of what that was all about and how black women fared out in that. And of course, one of the things that selected Negro males on the plantation were offered is their own flock. This was an elevated social status that was awarded, anointed, and appointed by the slave master that was the very first time that we could locate in the history of America, particularly within the institution of slavery, where such a esteemed, elevated status was offered to an enslaved African through the advent of the Negro preacher. And of course, we talked a little bit about what the Bible instructed him to do and teach, and the reasons why he was so ordained to do such, and how that has again, that was the precursor, the forerunner for the Christian experience of today. And it wasn't an indictment, nor is it an indictment on Christianity, but we do have to look at the roles in which our relationship to Christianity, you know, fosters rape culture. And the book lays that out in a very beautiful way. And so that's why I would encourage you to get a hold of the book to better understand that. And also, where we left off with regard to the religion chapter is when the Negro preacher was awarded his own flock, and he was a liaison between the master and the enslaved, and of course, God Almighty himself. He was given a stage, this elevated platform and a rostrum from which he was able to speak, and folks were gathered to hear him in a very traditional power dynamic in the way the European had rolled out his brand of leadership. So that's just a short summary of kind of a little bit of what we talked about last time on the mini Rona reading of the Resolving Rape Culture book written by me. And that book actually came out 2 months ago to the date. So under the circumstances of everything that's happened, I'm really pleased with folks who have the book, and the feedback has been tremendous. I get texts and DMs and messages frequently about where people are with the book, and I will tell you that it was written with the intent for the commentary and work around what's actually in the book to be just as rich as what's in the book, because this is not the end all be all. This book is little more than 150 pages. And that's on purpose, because it could have been as long as a phone book. But, you know, folk wouldn't read that. Even though we got quarantine time, it wasn't written with that in mind. And it's not written so that it is a literary masterpiece where regular black folk are not able to access the information. Now, there are some complex concepts within the book, but they are still easily digestible and understandable, and nothing to be intimidated by. And so tonight, very briefly, looking at the athletics chapter, which is the A in the RAPE acronym. And this chapter has a serious history, because this chapter was initially 57 pages long. The athletics chapter on the initial writing was 57 pages long. Now, I said the book is little more than 150 pages long, and we've got about 8 or 9 chapters, so there's just no way that was a reasonable and balanced contribution for the one chapter to be so long. But part of the reason the chapter was so long is because what in the world could possibly be wrong with athletics? Or how in the world could athletics be associated with rape culture? Or how could athletics be adverse to the relational aspect between black women and black men, given how athletics tends to bring so much joy to so many? And so, you know, for folks who thought the religion chapter was challenging in that it dealt with very sensitive and controversial subject matter, I assure you, the athletics chapter, at least from the feedback I've gotten, particularly from black men who are in the process of reading the book or reading the chapter, this chapter has been particularly difficult. Not because there's a lot of hard things in there, but it is something to confront about why we like what we like. And so, again, the chapter initially was 57 pages. It's nowhere near that now, but I did some condensing, and even in condensing, this chapter is broken down into about 8 different parts, even though it's a chapter. It's a singular chapter. It's broken down into 8 different parts. Of course, in the interest of time, I'm not going to read all 8 of those, but you can read it if you have your book. You can get your book out if you have it and read along. If you are interested, the link to getting the book is in the description for this particular video. It'll take you right to it. If you're local New Orleans, we can arrange something where you can get it quicker, and otherwise it'll be shipped out to you. And I would encourage you to get it sooner than later, because there's some issues around the post office where they're saying there may or may not keep going for financial reasons. I'm not sure exactly how all that works, but you know, there again, if you're interested, sooner than later would be better. But in this chapter, as in many other chapters, I offer some of my own personal story, and then I get into some of the things that are more relevant to the collective of our people that sort of lets you know that my personal story isn't so unique. And so I'm going to begin here in the Athletics chapter on page 39. This is in 39 in the revised edition, but if you have the initial edition, it's still within the Athletics chapter on the second page. And it says, Sundays, while the game was on, was a good time to go out and play because the men in the neighborhood could get away from their wives for a while to watch it. The married women would generally cook, find chores for their children, or stay to themselves while the game was on. Needless to say, going out to play was a popular option for children during game time. The young boys my age sometimes had to watch their sisters, and as a result, could not always come outside. And if they did come out to play, their sisters would have to come too. I was the only child in my house, so this arrangement with all its stipulations was curious to me. On rare occasions, if we had an odd number of boys, someone's sister may get drafted to play. As our play developed over time into more organized games, dividing ourselves into teams, like they did on television, made sense and more fun. The best of these times was when it was all boys, because we could really play hard and get physical, if that is what it took to score to win. Though there were times when someone's sister had to play to make the team numbers even, no one ever wanted the girls or girls on their team. Whoever got the girl or girls wanted to start off with extra points because everyone recognized girls on your team were a handicap. As this was customary compensation for the disadvantage of having to play with a girl or girls on your team, a young boy had to be a really good athlete to win with those odds against him. I suppose to some extent, we thought we could control the outcome by doing this. Occasionally, that young boy was me. I could win with girls on my team, or not. Sometimes I lost, and I was not happy about it. But if you have a girl or girls on your team and you're playing football or basketball, they are going to get messed over because they generally cannot stick the boys on the other team, really. The opposing team knows that whoever is being guarded by the girl is a weakness for my team, and I cannot stick my man and guard theirs too. None of us could. However, whenever I did win, even with a girl or girls on my team, the other boys would be furious, and I would tease them too. Man, you got beat by a girl, I'd gloat. The funny thing was, they would only have mean things to say to the girls, and over time became much more hostile and even violent in some instances. Generally, no one responded directly to me or other boys who would win with girls on their team because they knew what was being said was true. And after a loss to a team with a girl or girls on it, some young boys would rather just quit or want to play another kind of game or just go inside. Losing this way was shameful. So in that part of it, and again, that's very early, I'm just easing into the work and I'm using some of my own experience with that. The brothers who read this kind of concur all over, even though this was my experience here in New Orleans, brothers all over the country would kind of concur about that kind of a thinking and what the expectations were and what the tension was around just play. You know, even something is simple and innocent as play. And so if anyone who's watching or will watch this is an educator, you know how serious play in sports is, particularly for young black boys. You know that, like, if it's recess, they got to get one more shot in. And a lot of the times, these are not the boys who are the highly performing academic brothers or the necessarily behavioral compliant brothers, generally, who got to get one more shot in. So there's a very deep and intensive thing around sports and athletics and fun and freedom, traditionally for just black boys here in America. Of course, later on in the book, even in the chapter, we get down into why. And so let me see here. So this one right here says, the brothers in the neighborhood who got teased hard, and ribbing would usually go something like this. A smaller boy would miss a short throw or an easy layup, and someone would accuse him of playing like a girl, particularly if winning the game was on the line. If the young brother being teased didn't answer back, someone else would say he was a coward, or call him an old bitch-ass nigga, or a pussy-ass nigga. If a boy got clowned hard enough, often enough, he'd fight the first person egging it on. Usually the brother being teased wouldn't win this fight and would be taunted that he fights like a girl or hits like a little bitch. If he wouldn't fight, he got the standard punk-ass nigga or punk pussy-ass nigga or whore-ass nigga lobbed at him from the group. If things got bad enough, the little brother would just sob in frustration and run home, to which someone would yell, look at you, always out here crying like a little bitch. Go run to your mom. And so that kind of sets the stage for a lot of things that would occur, you know, later on. Now, I had a relationship with the older men in the neighborhood, and the book kind of goes into that. I would kind of hang out with them, you know, from as young as 4 or 5 years old, and sit at their feet and listen to them talk about, you know, all manner of things, particularly women, and how to keep one or two or whatever you needed. The book goes into that in great detail, because there was a place where they gathered. These men had retired and what have you, and the book talks a lot about that. A piece of that, it talks a little bit about the Sunday rituals. It says the variety of Sunday and summer rituals were to alternate my time between the boys my age and the old dudes. As time went on, my grandma would sometimes stick her head outside the door and tell me to go play with the young boys up the street and to leave those old men be. Occasionally, I would take her up on that, especially if certain youngsters were outside, because I like playing rough, really rough. And the strongest boys on the block preferred the physical contact kind of play the most, because we could prove who was more of a man, which was the quickest in a one-on-one contest of any kind. So, it says, when the girls were inside, we could really play fight without one of them going to tell on us. Those made for really good times. The competition was tough enough without the girls getting in our business that way. But as we would learn, that's what girls do until you stop them. There were certain boys, and we all knew who they were, that if they got told on, they would be sure to teach that snitch a painful lesson. Boys knew not to tell, but girls ended up getting hurt sometimes. After all, why would a girl tell on a boy who was fighting and expect not to get hurt? They had been told to mind their business and didn't. What did they think would happen? We learned early that some girls just didn't listen and liked to cause trouble. And so there's a little foreshadowing there about what's going to happen. And again, this is with peers and teenage boys. Well, not even, this is preteen, actually, preteen. And so here it talks a little bit about the older cats. And so the OGs at the table, this is their gathering spot, would cut up too, especially if everyone had been drinking and the game was on the radio. Someone might have one of those raggedy black and white portable televisions with the bad reception, but high quality audio. And if the Saints were playing, the old men gave the players the blues. If they missed a field goal, someone would be screaming how the coach was a pussy-ass nigga. because he should have gone for the first down, or the way the referees were making questionable calls that were in the opposing team's favor. Those refs were some blind bitches. Don't let a defender miss a tackle. He was a hoe for that, or a little scary ass bitch. Whether it was the radio or a raggedy portable television, it got the blues if the team was losing. Granted, whether it was football, baseball, basketball, boxing, or wrestling, when golf, tennis, hockey, soccer, and lacrosse weren't on the airwaves as much back then, older black men in particular really lived vicariously through these teams and individual star athletes, as long as they were winning. No one ever really gravitated to the losing teams. And so, again, some of the older men would reminisce about how they played the game back in high school, college, or even park ball. They could tell you all about the performance stats of individual players. It was nothing to catch an argument that was thought about which players were better. That argument would morph into, that's why your old lady won't give you no pussy. And you gotta buy it from these hoes out here smoking rocks, you trick bitch you. Some might get clowned about having to ask permission to buy something from that old nosy ass bitch that you let up all in your business. A brother may express joy in just being out of the house and away from that old nagging ass motherfucker. And so now, that was really from part one of the athletics chapter. That was really just from part one, and of course it wasn't all of it because we don't have that kind of time. But part two shifts things a little bit into a historical context to talk a little bit about where this comes from. So for the last century, professional athletics has been marketed to black men and boys as a fundamental problem-solving technology. The ultimate and primary means of confrontation of self-identified problems is through physicality. That problem is essentially an opposer or opposition to one's own will. Concurrently, this opponent or opponents also perceives your will in direct conflict with their will. Athletics offers but one paradigm, and that is a win-lose possibility. Therefore, one must compete for dominance of wills, and the victor essentially earns their worthiness to belong. The loser is in fact worth less. And so, enslaved Africans recognized slavery as the problem preventing a full human experience. These opposing views of the same scenario provided the basis for competition of wills, though slave masters were best equipped and positioned to utilize violence to maintain their desired order. This violence was meticulously applied in particularly strategic ways. It was organized, it was controlled, it was coordinated in a way that fostered group psychology as a fundamental doctrine of American values and virtues. And this organized, controlled, and coordinated violence would reemerge in the wider athletic culture of the early 1900s in a pseudo-militaristic structured arrangement for entertainment purposes only, which we know as athletics. And so now it shifts a little bit to the political aspect, which also is the P in the RAPE acronym, but there's a little bit of history, just a little bit of history in here that ties this together. And I'm going to move to part three. It says, with the limitation of the win-lose paradigm, one can only solve the problem of opposition through competition, and the best man wins. There can exist no cooperation in this arrangement because the two sides are enemies. You are on one side or the other. We refer to those sides as teams or organizations as a result of group psychology. Who won slavery? Which side was victorious in 1865? Though much is made about the significance of that year, 1870 really was a game changer for formerly enslaved African men because new possibilities existed. The 15th Amendment awarded black men the right to vote. The first black man competed and won a Senate seat that year, proving his worthiness. He won against all of his competition and solidified the creed, all men created equal. A black man born just 8 years later in 1878 named Jack Johnson would also find himself to be another first for free black men. In 1908, at 30 years old, he would defeat Tommy Burns and become world heavyweight champion, champion using organized, controlled, and coordinated violence now available to him. Essentially, Tommy Burns was the problem between him and the title. Titles remain extremely critical in American society as means of identifying winners and losers. For Jack Johnson, winning the title resulted in substantial financial compensation, unlike that of typical Negro men of that era. To be clear, enslaved African men and boys and the black men and boys who descended from them have historically physically labored under some of the most grueling and perilous conditions known to America. However, it was not until they were to be paid for their labor that they had a problem finding work. Now, Jack Johnson was an anomaly, and he was only allowed a short and perhaps colorful life because white men were able to profit from his work. Yes, he married three different white women, and that was also allowed because the profit potential for his use of the same problem-solving technology perfected on the plantation, though contained in a controlled setting, surpassed any political fears associated with controversy. And so that's just taking a look at where now the black man is able to use his body physically to create and shape realities for himself and to get paid. And he's only allowed to do so because there is a white man or a group of white men who are sanctioning this that are able to profit handsomely off of that. That's really important to know. So in part four, it says, before we move from the individual to return to a deeper look at how group psychology and teamwork makes the dream work, it is vital that we pause our analysis to observe what is not mentioned and why. Black men are voting and competing against white men for political seats. Black men are eligible to become highly compensated professional athletes. What was occurring with the newly freed, formerly enslaved African women and girls during the same 43-year period? Did we even notice their absence? And that just speaks to how this was happening, and this is historical fact, and it's easy to locate this. But there's, you know, what was happening with the formerly enslaved African women who are today politically designated as black? What was happening with them wasn't major news or major interest, and a lot was happening. Since the plantation days of the Negro preacher, white men had offered selected enslaved African men an exclusive invitation to their patriarchal dominance in America's social power structure. White men did not offer such membership, though limited, partial, and provisional, to enslaved African women and girls, nor freed black girls, not on the plantation and not since the Emancipation Proclamation. For sanity's sake, it must be emphasized that at no time in the history of America has the politically designated black man or black woman defined themselves for themselves. Kujichagulia, which is self-determination, did not even begin to find its way into the vernacular of the collective black consciousness until a century after the slaves were freed. We must be unwavering in acknowledging that it has always been the dominance of the white men who have defined people, places, things, statuses, priorities, values, and outcomes throughout America's duration. White men declared black women and girls as less than black men through social political recognition and reaffirmed their inferior status through social invisibility. By this we can conclude the dominant American cultural lens values black women and girls as insignificant as compared and contrasted to its alliance with black men historically. And so again, this is only part four of an eight part chapter. This next part, it will probably be the last part that I do, just in the interest of time, deals a little more with the data and brings us closer, but it nowhere rounds out the chapter. But I'm going to give you this because it's short enough and yet dense enough. It says, yes, professional football may be fun for some to watch, fun for others to play, and fun for team or organization owners to own. But the players earn money for the owners, and the owners pay the players. The watchers or viewers pay for it all. These are the fans, which is short for fanatics. Now, of the 32 professional football teams, not one principal owner is a black man nor black woman. In 2019, more than 70% of NFL players are black men. CEOs, head coaches, and quarterbacks are upwards of 80 to 100% white and predominantly men. Therefore, white men own the organizations. The organized, controlled, and coordinated violence applied to black men, overwhelmingly by other black men, as they fiercely battle for organizational team supremacy, is financially rewarding for the black men who have only been legally eligible to earn money for their labor for the last six generations. In 2019, they earned 87 cents for every dollar white men earned for doing the same job. Professional football may be the exception. However, only 2% of NCAA seniors, which is where the majority of NFL players come from, will be drafted by an NFL team. Statistically, black men make up a significant portion of a small percentage of total players. The data goes on to indicate that high school seniors that go on to play in college is less than 6%. Only 0.09% of high school seniors are eventually drafted to the NFL. Therefore, we can conclude that even with over 70% of NFL players being black men, we are talking about around 1,190 brothers earning a median salary of $860,000 annually. There are over 47 million black folks in America today, and black men comprise 48% of the black population, according to the U.S. Census. The median income for all workers in the U.S. is just over $63,000 annually. And as of 2009, the median income for black men in the U.S. was just under $24,000. So what about black women? Now, there's more to this chapter, but really just in the interest of time, I know there are many other things happening. And I want you all to, again, if you have the books, dig into that. There's more even in that chapter. But this chapter is really, really critical. Again, it was 57 pages initially, and it's lengthy, but comparable to other chapters. But it does have eight distinct parts to it, and we've gone through just about five of those, but not in their totality. But I want folks to really understand the controlled, the organized, controlled, and coordinated violence. In the fact that athletics, particularly professional athletics, but athletics in general, has been marketed to black men over the last 100 years as a problem-solving or conflict resolution technology. And that marketing has shaped the ways in which we engage each other and also black women. And the chapter goes much, much deeper into that. And you can have the opportunity. If you have the book, of course, you know, or if you've read it, you know, and if you haven't got to that yet, I encourage you to really go slow with the athletics chapter and take some really good notes. The back of the book has a good bit of blank pages, I think about 20 or so, for you to take notes for things that you may need to come back to or things you want to research or what have you. And if you do have the book already, I appreciate the support, and I also welcome the feedback and the dialogue around what's in the book. Folks have been calling or texting and DMing or what have you, and we've been having some really good dialogue around the things that are in the book and how they impact us today. So this is from Resolving Rape Culture, written by me, Brother Shaq, True Love Movement, and it is available now. There is a link in the description of this video. There is another, two other mini, I call them mini Rona readings, since we're not able to gather and do book readings and book signings and what have you. But there are two other, and they're on my timeline. One is the introduction to the book. If you've not seen that, I encourage you to check that out, as well as the a reading from the religion chapter, also on the timeline, and again on the True Love Movement TV YouTube channel. I strongly encourage you to get this book. I think every black family should have this book, and this is a time that, you know, we didn't know we were going to have this time, but this Resolving Rape Culture book, I think, is a good addition to your quarantine reading list, at any rate. So I would ask you to share this particular video, as well as the other videos that are associated with Resolving Rape Culture, the book, and to know that there is also a Resolving Rape Culture workshop that has been out for a couple of years, even preceding the book, that we are working to do on a virtual basis. So having the book already and having some knowledge of the book and the analysis in the book will make the workshop that much more meaningful, because we're not just talking about something here. There's a lot of action. Action is when you resolve something, you make a definite determination on the action that you're going to take. And so, family, that's what Resolving Rape Culture essentially is: the religion, athletics, politics, and entertainment. Tonight I've read to you from the athletics chapter, and I look forward to hearing from you and shipping out a book for you, or dropping one off to you here in the city of New Orleans over the next recent time, until the post office or the other powers that be attempt to confine us even more during this quarantine time. So I ask that you stay safe and stay well. And my hope is that your family is well, and we are in as good a shape as we can be, given the circumstances. And while you're quarantining, read Resolving Rape Culture by me, Brother Shaq. Share this video again with folks you respect. Check out the other videos. There's actually a good interview too that I had the chance to do right before the release on February 11th with our good brother O.T. Oliver Thomas on the Good Morning Show on WBOK 12:30 a.m. That is also in the timeline, that shows you where the two black men are dialoguing about this and how the complexities and the awkwardness and the discomfort is a very real thing just around discussing the topic. But we're confronting that. Good black men are, in fact, authentically good black men are, in fact, confronting that, and with a lot of pride. So again, I thank you for joining me. Thank you for tuning in. Brother Shaq, homies.